Okay, so we're going to build this cool scrolling carousel component. You can see as you scroll through it, we get like progress and it transitions between each of these cards. This is something I actually stole from the Chronicle website, which is a great site that's made in Framer, so you should go check that out. Okay, so the first thing I pretty much always do is put together the design in Figma. I just find it much quicker to work in Figma. And the import to Framer is pretty good. So here I've got the design. If I move this, you can see sort of how it's laid out. So let's select the scroll carousel and copy it over to Framer. This plugin is the plugin that Framer makes to import Figma components into Framer. And it's really good because it'll remember like auto layout settings and everything, so you don't have to build it twice. So if we do that, then we hop over to Framer. We've got our website put together here. And we just sort of copy it in. And we're going to set the width to fill, and while we're here, I'm just going to set a max width of 1200 pixels so it matches the rest of the site. Okay, now let's think about how we're actually going to build this thing. The first question you should always ask yourself is, should I make a component out of this? And the answer is almost always yes, unless one of these things is true. You need it to respond to scroll events, or you need to scale something. So if we have a look at the finished product, you can see that we need this scroll indicator to respond to the scroll position. And you'll notice that the transition between the cards, one scales in and one scales out. We have access to all of these effects, but we don't have access to these within components. And we need a lot of these effects to make our transitions work. So in this case, we're not going to make a component out of the whole thing. What I am going to do is make a component out of just the card. Okay, so I quickly made a basic component out of this card. I've just added variables for all of the fields, so the title, image, and the text down here. Nothing fancy. First up, let's make this scroll indicator over here. All we need to do is make this internal container a fixed height. So the progress container over here, we're going to make it 400, and then we're going to set the indicator, this blue thing inside of it, to be fill. So it takes up 100% of the available space. So next up, we want to add a scroll transform to the indicator. The way we do that is hit scroll transform and then go in here and select our from animation. A scroll transform animates something based on the scroll position. Here we want to animate the indicator's Y position from an offset of -300. Remember, the container's height is 400, and we want to make sure that it doesn't scale or fade in, so we set those both to 1, and we want the 2 value to just be 0. Now, we also only want this to happen when we scroll into this section, so what we're going to do is select Section and View, but before we can select the section, we have to go give this a name. Select the parent and add a scroll section ID, so we're going to add a name here, and let's call this carousel container. And if we go back to the indicator, we can select carousel container, and we want to make it so that this is triggered when this section is in the middle of the viewport. So now if we go preview that, we can see that as we scroll past, it animates down, which is exactly what we wanted. If I go back and remove the overflow hidden and preview it again, you can see exactly what's happening here. You can see we're just animating the Y position of this element as we scroll through this section. Okay, now that that's working, we can get the rest of the effect in place. The first thing to do is select the scroll feature card and duplicate it 3 times because we need 3 of them. And I'm going to fill out all the content for each one. Okay, cool. Now that they're all filled out, I'm going to select them all and I'm going to wrap them in a stack. I'm going to drag the corners of this stack so that it only takes up roughly the area we want. Then I'm going to set all of the children to absolute. We do that. We make sure that all of them have 0 offsets all round. And now we can set the parent to fit. I find that if you don't do it in that order, Framer will start to freak out with the absolute offset. So just make it roughly the right size first and then set it to fit. Now we need to set these so they're in the right order. I'm going to change their names so it's easier to work with. Okay, so now that that's done, let's have a quick refresher on how position sticky works, because it's at the core of this effect. If I hop over to Figma, I've made some diagrams that sort of explain what position sticky is doing. So each of these little rectangles is a div, and they're all set to position relative. But this one has a child with position sticky. And this thing over here is the viewport, so it's what you see as you scroll down the page. So if we scroll down a little bit further till the point at which the parent of the position sticky element is in view, you'll see that what happens is the position sticky element starts to stick to the viewport. So as you keep scrolling, the position sticky element is just docked to the top or the bottom or the left or the right, wherever you set it, it's docked to the viewport. But it's only docked to that viewport as long as the parent container is in the viewport. As soon as you scroll past the bottom of the parent container, the position sticky item stops sticking. We're going to use this effect to make it look like our scroll carousel has taken up the whole viewport. So let's go and get started. So the first thing we're going to do is select the parent, the scroll container element here, and we're going to set its height to viewport, and then we're going to make it really tall. We're going to set it to 400 VH, which means it'll be four times the height of the viewport. So if we zoom out, we can see what that's done. And I'm going to give the parent a funky colored background so that we can see sort of what's going on. So the next thing we need to do is wrap these things in a frame. So what we're going to do is add a stack, and we're going to set this to space between. We're going to set the width to fill, and we're going to set the height to viewport. In this case, we want 100 VH, so we want it to take up the whole viewport. I'm also going to give this a little bit of a funky background so we can see what's going on. And here's where the magic happens. We change its type from relative to sticky. We're not going to do anything with the offset for now, but let's preview that and see what happens. Okay, so when we get down to the container, we can see that nothing's really happened. The element is sort of down the bottom, but once we get there, it sticks sort of exactly how we want. So we need to go back and set the parent. We want the alignment so that this is at the top. So if we do that again, we should get roughly the result we want. There we go. So we can't actually see any of the background color, which means this is taking up the whole viewport height. And it sticks exactly how we want in the middle of the screen the whole time we're scrolling through the parent element, which is great. Okay, so all that's left is to create the transitions between these cards. The way we're going to do this is by using a scroll animation that's triggered when a user scrolls to a certain point in the parent. But what are we going to use to trigger this animation? I'm going to show you a neat little trick I use quite a lot in this situation. So within the parent container, the one with the red background, what I'm going to do is press S and add a stack. I'm going to just drag it across like that. I'm going to give it a even funkier colored background so we can see it. Then I'm going to set it to be absolute. So it sort of disappeared behind other stuff. I'm going to bring it up with a Z index for now, but I'll undo that later. We want the width to be 100%, and we want the height to be 100%. Okay, so now we have something that's taking up the whole of the parent container. And what we're going to do is we're going to add three frames within this. So I just draw out a frame. You'll see it's sort of in the middle. So I'm going to select this frame. I'm going to set its width to fill and its height to fill. And then I'm going to duplicate it three times. Let's make sure that our parent is actually a row component. And let's get rid of the gap. And then again, I'm going to give each of these like a slightly different shade of blue so we can see them. Now, if I select the pink row component, I'm going to hit the Z index so it goes behind everything again. Okay, cool. So why have I done this and made all these funny colored frames? Well, the idea is that each of these will be a trigger for the animation that happens underneath it. So in order to use them as a trigger, we need to give them a scroll ID. So with all of them selected, hit the plus next to scroll section and let's give them a name, call them scroll trig. And then one by one, I'm going to give them a number. Okay, so now I'm going to take the funky background color off of this thing so we can see behind it. And what we're going to do is we're going to set some of these animations. Select our number one, and we're going to go effects, scroll animation. And you can see that gives us an enter and an exit animation. But because this one's going to be visible by default when you scroll down to it, it actually doesn't need an entry animation. So we're going to get rid of that. And if we go into the exit animation, you can see it gives us some defaults. So by default, it's fades out to zero and scales down. But we also want it to move about 200 pixels in the Y direction. You'll notice that we can't actually see anything. There should be a preview of the animation. And that's because our parent has the overflow set to hidden. So if we change that and jump back into our animation, you should be able to see the preview. So that looks like it's scaling a little bit too much. We probably want this to be about 0.8. And make sure that that's zero. And now we want this to be triggered when we get down to this transition between the medium blue and the pale blue. So what we're going to do is set section in view, and we're going to select scroll trigger 1. I'm going to make sure that when that's in the middle of the viewport, that this animation happens. And we're going to set replay to yes. So if we preview this, we can see that, boom, as we hit that line, we're getting the transition we want. Now we just need to go ahead and make the entry and exit transitions for the rest of the cards. So select number 2, and let's add a scroll animation. This one's going to have both an entry and an exit animation. So we're going to start with the entry animation. We want it to come from the top, so we're going to say -200, and we're just going to raise this so we can see what's happening, and then we're going to make that about the same, 0.8, and then we're going to set the exit animation. You'll notice that by default it copies the animation. You can change that by deselecting this little lock over here. And if we go back, we actually want this to go out in the other direction. So it'll be 200 in the other direction. If we preview that, we can see that it's right. And we want the scroll trigger to be scroll trig 2 in the middle and replay. And now the last one we need to do is number 3. If we add a scroll animation, this one isn't going to have an exit transition. So we just get rid of that straight away, but it is going to come from the top. So -200, 0.8. Now we need to make sure that that section is set to scroll trigger 3 in the middle and replay. So if we go preview this now, it should be working sort of how we expect. Okay, brilliant. The last thing to do is to remove all of these random background colors we've added to everything. One important thing to remember to do is we've got these sort of like invisible trigger frames we've added. It's always a good idea to just set the pointer events on those to none. In case they end up overlaying anything you want the user to interact with. Now, if we preview this, we should have the exact effect we wanted in the beginning. So that's it for this video. I hope you found it useful, and if you did, that's great, because this is a part of my Advanced Framer course, which you can find at advancedframer.com. Catch you next time.